Cheers, folks. Vapor Noob here. Today's tutorial is going to be on your first build with the Subtank Mini RBA deck. If you're watching this video, it means you're just getting into building your own coils. You're not really sure how it works, what to do, what you're going to need. You've never done it before, and you're really just looking for somebody to kind of walk you through it, hold your hand, and help you get that first one done. It can be a little bit of, you know, a little bit intimidating, but trust me, it's easy as shit to do, and you can do it. Trust me, if I can do it, you can do it. And, you know, it's really simple, it's really easy. Unfortunately, this is going to be a long video probably. Unfortunately, because of my YouTube status, I think I'm going to have to put this up in two parts because I think I'm limited to like 15 minutes of video, and this is probably going to take about a half an hour. So it's probably going to be, you know, a two-part video. But what we're going to do is, you know, I'm going to bring the camera down onto the table where I'm working, and I'm going to show you this. I'm not going to be zooming in really tight, like super tight, because I just don't have a camera for that, but you're going to be able to see essentially what I'm doing, and you'll get the gist of it. How's it going? Okay, so first things first, let's go over the what you're going to need to do this this tutorial, this build. Of course, the star of the show is going to be the Kanger Tech Subtank Mini. This is one that I have here. I've cleaned it out. You may notice that the glasses looks a little foggy. That's because I just washed it out, and a little bit of water vapor, I guess, was still in there. It won't kill you. Trust me. It won't kill you. Smokes are killing you. This won't kill you. A little bit of water. Anyway, you may notice too, I have a little adapter here. Just ignore that. I mean, it's just my personal preference, how I like to vape. It's just a little adapter. I like a little more height on my, that's the standard Subtank Mini. Yeah, I just use a adapter. I just like my actual lips to be further away from the atomizer. Where the actual vaporizing of your e-juice happens, a little bit further away, it cools down the vapor just a little bit. So that's what that is. So of course you're going to need your tank. The other things you're going to need: wire. This is Lightning Vapes. It's 24 gauge or American wire gauge. Canthal A1. It's a really good starting point if you're going to build on the Subtank. It's really easy to use. It's big enough that, you know, it's not like trying to work with hair, something the size of hair. It's a good size. It's going to give you a good coil, and it's going to produce a good vape experience. The other thing you're going to need, you're going to need, well, of course, the RBA deck. This is a this tank and this deck is version 2. I'm assuming that's what you're going to be using. Again, here, let me see if I can. That's it right there. That's the deck. I'm assuming this is what you're going to be using because this is pretty much what the standard is now that's available. If you bought your tank anytime in the last month or so, that would be, you know, July or August of 2015. This is what you're going to get. We'll go into that a little bit more in a bit. The other things you're going to need, the proverbial blue screwdriver. This comes with virtually every product sold with an e-cigarette comes with a screwdriver. I'm not sure why every single one has to, but of course if you don't have a screwdriver, then you'll be awfully glad that you got one in that little bag in your little kit of stuff that comes with your Subtank, because of course without a screwdriver you're not going to be doing any of this. The other thing that you're going to need, that you know, is some cotton. Now, this is, I believe it's It's Japanese cotton. It comes with the product. It comes in a bag. I'll use this for the purpose of the tutorial. Again, it came with your kit. Things that did not come with your kit that you really will need for this, pair of scissors, sharp. You're going to need to cut that cotton. And I mean, I use these. I bought them at the drugstore. I mean, they're ladies' scissors for, I think, trimming eyebrows or something. I don't know. But they work really well for this because they're small and sharp. Some wire cutters. Again, something that, you know, they didn't send with your kit, but you're definitely going to want to have some wire cutters. You're going to need to not only cut the wire off this blow, you're going to have to trim up the leads once you put the coil into the deck. Definitely some good flush cut wire cutters. Again, flush cut, look for something that's flush cut. You want to be able to trim as close to the deck as possible, because any little bit of metal burr that sticks out could in fact come in contact with the barrel, meaning the outside edge of this, which of course would cause a short, and you don't want that. And then lastly, the thing you're going to need is, again, you don't actually need this, but you know, if you're not using a screwdriver, I just have a small flat tip screwdriver that I use for, you know, poking and prodding and, you know, getting my cotton right. If you don't have one of these, you could use a piece of wire. You can cut a small, you know, piece of your 24 gauge Canthal and use it to, you know, pick your cotton and, you know, pick your cotton. This isn't about cotton picking. Anyway, you could use a piece of wire to manipulate your cotton, move it around, get your wicking perfect. But I personally love to use just a regular little straight screwdriver. Now, those are things that you're going to need minimum. Sort of explain to you a few things that you would, I'd like to say are nice to haves. First thing, ceramic tweezers. If you're going to be building a coil and you want the coils to be touching, you're definitely going to want tweezers. If you don't want it touching, you're essentially going to have to build what's called a spaced coil, which means you're building it with space between each wrap of the coil. In which case, when you build like that, you don't actually have to check for what's called hot spots. Again, if you start getting into building, you definitely will want a pair of ceramic tipped sweet tweezers. The ceramic tip means that I can grab the coil even while it's firing, and I don't risk shorting it out or melting my tweezers. Really good to have, pretty cheap too. Like I think I paid like $8 for these at my local vape shop. Again, a really nice thing to have. Another nice thing to have is a mandrel. Now I got this particular one again at a local vape store here in the Toronto area. This is a nice little tool to wrap coils as well as place coils. In fact, this particular one, even if I can undo this, comes with a little screwdriver even attached to it. I don't know what it is about the e-cigarette world, but everything comes with a screwdriver. Again, nice to have, not necessary. The other thing is, you'll notice that I have a different piece of cotton here. This cotton is good. This cotton is better. The Cogendo that comes with your RBA, it's good. Trust me, I've used this. It's good. It is good. This is cotton bacon. Just a name brand that's sold to vapers. It's a little more expensive, but you know what? It's better. So when I actually build, I'm going to show you both ways to wick your coil, like using both cottons, just so that we've covered, you know, bare minimum of what you need. Again, nice to have. Put that in the nice to have list. Another nice to have. I'll show you this, but when I build the coil for the RBA deck, I will actually be wrapping it around the little blue screwdriver because I know that you have the little blue screwdriver. I'm not sure you're going to have this. I don't want you to say, well, I've got to run out and spend, you know, $25 on a Coil Master kit. Forget that. But I will also show you this device and sort of explain to you what this is and see how, you know, if you are getting into building, you know, a measly like $25 US, this thing is awesome. Another nice to have. Okay, so let me explain what my tank is sitting on right now. If you see, I've got this little aluminum disc. It's just a little aluminum disc. It has a hole in the center for my 510 pin to fit in. It's just so that I can sit atomizers down and they sit flush, you know, they sit flat. They, you know, I'm not trying to, you know, balance them or put them in the center of my spool of wire or so. This little thing I got at my local vape shop for less than $3, like $2.49. So you can't go wrong with these. I also use them. I don't have a atomizer stand, you know, one of these big, you know, things with holes in it for putting all my atomizers and juices and mods in and stuff. I just use these to have my atomizer sitting, you know, in my little vape work area. They're great. They're so cheap. $2.50. Now, with that said, again, that's not needed. It's nice. This is something similar to this with a little bit of a difference. Now, first of all, if I flip it over this way, as you can see, it works just like that one. You know, it's just a stand to put your atomizer on. It sits on it and, you know, sits flush. The difference is this one, on the other side though, it's threaded. Meaning, I can take my tank, start screwing it in, and voila! I now have a, you know, something that's quite substantial and heavy to sit my deck on, my base, for when I'm working on the actual build. Really makes your life easy. Again, something I would, much like the Coil Master, I would definitely recommend if you're going to get into building. You know, get yourself something like this. I've seen other people use like a block of wood with a, you know, where they put a 510 connector. You know, the 510 connector, you can buy them like Fat Daddy Vapes is a store that sells 510 connectors. You can get a block of wood, put a, you know, a 510 connector in it, and that's going to, you know, do sort of the same thing. Give you somewhere that you can screw down your device. Now, a lot of people will do this, and I'm going to tell you right now, it's a bad idea. There's a lot of people who will work off of their device, meaning they'll screw it onto here, and this is how they'll use it to work on it. Problem with that is if you accidentally turn it on or leave it on or press the button, you know, if it is on and you're dry firing the coil and you accidentally hit the button while you're working on it, you're going to burn yourself, and that's not a good thing. So I highly recommend, or not only that, here's another one. You could end up, you know, putting too much pressure one way or another and break your 510 connector on your device or on your tank. So again, don't use your device to build on. It's really, really, really not recommended. So that's it for what you're gonna need. Okay, so let's start off by showing you and talking about the RBA deck that comes with your tank. A lot of people are going to, you know, get a little skittish thinking, oh my god, I can't build my own coils, that's just crazy, that's nuts. It really is a lot easier than you think. The fact that you're at Kanger sub-tank users and you're asking about this stuff means you've obviously made that, or you're, you know, thinking about taking that next step, building your own coils. And this is what you're going to do it on. So there's a few parts to this RBA deck, and I'm going to take it apart here and show you. As you can see, there's the bottom threading which goes into the base of your tank. This works much similar to a stock coil, meaning when you open your tank that first time to start this process, you're going to remove your stock coil and, you know, heave it. That's the whole point, right? You want to get into building your own coils. So the first thing is the top of the barrel has this little knurling on it. What you want to do is unscrew it. Just hold it kind of tight and start unscrewing it. It does have an O-ring on it. I don't know if you can see that, but it does have a clear O-ring here. So it can be a little stiff at first when it starts, but as you saw, it just fell. The threading on it is pretty smooth and comes off pretty easily. There's the inside. Now, of course, when you open yours, it should look almost exactly like mine, meaning Kanger's already put one coil in it already. In theory, you just need to open it, wick it, and you can vape on it. But that's not what this tutorial is all about. So the first thing we're going to do is open this up some more and take that out. So on the side, you're going to see a tiny, tiny, tiny little screw. This little screw holds the barrel to the base of the RBA. Now, it's real important that when you loosen this to remove the barrel, don't take the screw out. Chances are, if you were to take it out and put it here, you're going to lose it. You're going to knock it over onto the floor, into your carpet, and unless you've got a strong magnet and start getting down on your hands and knees, it's going to be a nightmare. I do believe they do ship one extra in the bag, but I can tell you I've never lost mine. And the reason is because you don't actually remove it. You just loosen it a bit. Just put your little blue screwdriver in, give it like maybe a half turn or one turn. That's it. Hold the bottom and just pull it straight off. That's it. I mean, again, there's a little O-ring in here that gives it that tension, and you can see there's a little alignment notch. That's what goes right into that screw, and then that screw holds the barrel to the base. You just want to give it a half turn and then take your barrel off, put your barrel aside. It's small, but don't be concerned. I've got pretty big hands, and if I can do this, you can do this. So first things, let's get rid of that Kanger coil that comes in it. You're just going to want to take your screwdriver and loosen off these set screws. Again, you don't want to remove them, much like the little one for the barrel. You just want to loosen them up quite a bit, because you want to get some room, because you're going to have to fit wires in between them. And there's the coil falling out. And you're going to want to just leave them up a little bit so that, when we start building, we can get our leads underneath those screws, trap the leads, and then tighten them down. So we're going to take Kanger's coil, and we're going to, and again, if you're, I don't know if you can see that, that is what's called a spaced coil. Let me see, I'm going to try to put it up close for you, but I don't know how well that's going to go. I'm not sure how well this camera can self-focus, but let me pick it up with my tweezers and start moving it in and see if maybe you might be able to see it. Like I say, it's a spaced coil, so the each wrap, each roll is not touching each other. They're spaced apart. We won't be building one that's spaced like this. Don't get me wrong, these work really well, but that's not what you're here. Okay, now we've got our deck apart, and for me, again, I'm going to screw it into my my little tool here, because it just makes life that much simpler. Anytime you can, when you're working with small stuff, if you can get something to hold your piece while you work on it, and I mean, this thing's pretty heavy. You know, this thing weighs probably, you know, a couple of ounces. So, you know, as I go to move or tug or do stuff, it's pretty good at staying still, you know, and that's the idea or the concept behind it. So let's start by getting a piece of wire. Okay, almost every spool that you buy is going to, you know, come like this. They have a little notch. I'm going to pull this piece of wire out. And as you can see, 24 gauge, it's pretty stiff. It's pretty springy. I'm just going to want one revolution, meaning where I took it out of that spot, I'm going to put it right back in. So one revolution. It's one, you know, that's about all you need. I'll put a little mark there, or bend it over so that it doesn't unravel on me, and just use my wire cutters and have it bounce across the table. Again, very springy. Again, another good tip, anytime you're using the wire cutters and you're doing building and you're snipping things into, you're going to want to put your fingers around little edges and stuff. I'll show you that later, because you don't want a little, you know, 2 millimeter long piece of wire go flying across your room and end up in the carpet. Because I'll guarantee you, maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow, but sometime you're going to find it. And how you're going to find it is it's going to be jammed, stuck into your foot, and it's going to hurt like a son of a bitch. So be careful with your wire. You don't want it going everywhere on you. You want to kind of keep a close eye on where your wire and your little bits go. Okay, so here we go. Here's a piece of 24 gauge Canthal. Now this wire is pretty thick. I mean, you know, you can kind of, you know, I'm just running it through my fingers here, going against the curve, just kind of getting it a little straight, because when I work on it, I want it to be a little straight. And in fact, while we're at it, I'm going to take off my second piece, because when we do this, I'm also going to show you the Coil Master and how it works. So I'll need another piece for that. So let me get another piece ready. And we'll be using that a little bit later. Right. So what we're going to shoot for, what we're going to try to do, is we want to have 7 wraps around this little screwdriver. And this is a pretty simple process. All we're going to do is we're going to line it up with the handle of the screwdriver. I'm going to pinch it against the handle with my thumb, between my thumb and my forefinger, and I'm going to hold it pretty damn hard. You want to really hold it there, because you don't want it to move. And essentially now, I'm just going to work with this, and I'm going to go over the top and come around until it meets the metal of the screwdriver. And what I'm going to want to do, or what you're going to want to do, is as you start wrapping this around that screwdriver, you want to try to make sure that every time you wrap it, it's touching the spot just prior to it. You don't want it spaced out, you want it touching. Okay, so I'm going to grab that nice and tight, and in fact, I mean, this is another good tip. We're not going to put 7 wraps. 7 wraps is what we want, but we're actually going to put 8 on here. And the reason is because one end is ugly right now. It may not look like that to you, but it's ugly. And what we're going to want to do is put 8 wraps on, and then kind of flip it around and take 1 wrap out, take it away. So we actually want 8 wraps. So here we go. I'm just going to start wrapping this. And again, I'm keeping the pressure towards this way to make sure that every time it rotates, I'm getting it touching the wrap that was there before it. Now, you don't want to overlap them. You just want to make sure that they're touching. Six, 7, 8. Okay. Now, maybe I didn't have it touching. It's maybe not perfect, but what you can do is, while it's still sitting on the screwdriver, you can press it against the base of the screwdriver. Use your thumbnail and just run it along and press it against the base. That's all I'm doing. I'm just pressing it in to try to get it as tight as I can to, you know, against itself. That's pretty good. Okay, now, like I said, we're going to take one wrap out. And the way we're going to do that is by taking the end that was against the screwdriver. In fact, I can flip it around. I'm going to put it on the other end of the screwdriver now. Put the screwdriver through my coil from the other side. And I'm just going to pinch the wire between my fingernail and the... And actually, you know what? I'm going to get a pair of pliers because it's just that much easier. Again, one of those... Nice to have, well, I should prove it to you that it's not necessary. Little electrician's trick. You can use a cutter to be a plier as long as you don't put enough pressure to cut through. So I'm going to pull the wire back towards me, and as you can see, it's unwinding because that's it. I just wanted to take one of the winds out so that I have really sexy, nice, you know, seven wraps, touching, they look beautiful, you know, I'm just straightening the wire a little bit. Alright, so here we go, we've got our 24 gauge, seven wraps, let me just make sure there's seven wraps here, of course there is, and I'm just going to leave it on this screwdriver, and I'm going to place it over the center. If you look into the deck, there's a hole right in the center of that deck. What that is, that's your airflow. So when air comes into the base and up through the atomizer, past your coil, that's where it's going to come from. Now, as you can see here, we've got quite a bit of wire. I took off, you know, obviously more than I needed. It just makes life easy. So what we're going to do is, those screws are already out a little bit, and I'm going to place this coil right over the center hole on the deck, and I'm going to put the first lead under the screw that's closest to me. Actually, I'm holding the screwdriver there, and I have the lead going underneath each screw, and I'm trying to hold the coil in the center over the airflow. I will reach around and use a different screwdriver to tighten it down. No, I won't. I told you that we'd be doing it with the tools that we have, so that's what we're going to do. So now that I have the coil placed, I'm just going to hold one of these wires, I'm going to slip the screwdriver out, and I'm going to use the screwdriver to tighten the coil. And I'm going to tighten both screws. First, I'm just going to tighten it just a little bit. I'm not going to over-tighten it, and that's a really important thing too. You don't want to over-tighten. These screws are very prone to strip, as well as the base itself. So you don't want to over-tighten the screws. It's really important that you don't do that. It can be quite a nightmare. In fact, I've had to replace a base because I've stripped out the deck itself. And unless I go start, you know, maybe get either larger screws, or perhaps, you know, use a tap and die, you know, tap it out to a larger thread, which is ridiculous considering that you can pick up one of these for like $10. So you want to tighten them a little bit at first, and just to make sure that they're not going to move, and then you're going to want to hold it in your hand and just make sure that each one of those leads is trapped nice and tight. Again, not over tight, just nice and tight. Now if you look at that, I think you can see that. there's a bit of space. In fact, look, I've got my screwdriver. I can go right underneath that coil between there and the air space, in the air hole. What we want is we want that coil to be much closer to that air hole. We don't want it sticking way up in the air. And the reason for that is the higher this coil is, meaning it, the higher it is from the, on this deck, the closer it's going to be to the chimney. The chimney is what brings the vapor up to your mouth. And it's just a common understanding that the closer this is, the more likely it is that it's going to spit juice in your mouth. And that's not a pleasant thing. So we want to push this coil now down towards that air hole. But you definitely don't want to do anything like just put your finger on and push it, because what you'll do is collapse the coil. You'll crush the coil and, you know, you'll have to start over again. So typically what I'll do is put my screwdriver back in through the coil, and now using both hands. I wonder how you could use both hands if you didn't have a base like mine. Anyway, you can hold in one hand and push. You just want to push it down towards that air hole. Now, you don't want it touching the deck. Now, at first, when you push it down, that may be exactly what happens. You know, you look for space and you go, oh no, yeah, it's touching the deck. Well, obviously, you want to lift it up just a tiny, tiny little bit. Now, if I pull that screwdriver out, I don't know, again, we'll see if you can see that. I don't know how well the autofocus is on my Sony Handycam, but there's some space there. Now, that may be a little too much space. I'm probably going to tweak that and move it down just a little bit closer to the airflow. Okay, for me, the way I like it like that. I don't. Again, I'm hoping that this comes out on the video correctly. I will know during editing. And that's what you want right there. At this point, I'm confident we can go ahead and cut our leads. Now, you may have watched other videos on YouTube where guys will grab the leads and start bending them and stuff like that. I think that's just silly. You're putting a lot of stress and strain on those screws, and consequently, you have the potential to move your coil around. This is, again, the whole point of having a pair of flush cut pliers. Again, what the other tip I was telling you is be wire aware. Your little parts that you trim off, like this is about a 1-inch piece I have here. I cut this and it goes flying across the room. Like I said, chances are it's going to stick into somebody's foot and it's not going to be a pleasant experience. So you'll want to hold your wire, keep it from flying across the room. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut it as close as I can to that side, that metal. You want it really, really close. You don't want any little bit of wire going past the screw. Again, that has to do with touching the barrel and shorting out. We don't want that. So I'm going to put my flush cut pliers in on the outside here and just trim it up. Again, don't lose these. Don't let them, you know. And now the nice big long end, easy to do. Nice and close. There we go. Right, there it is. Looks pretty good. It's centered. That's the other part. You want to make sure if your coil's not centered. Oh, mine's not so centered. Perfect example. Let's spin this around. If you can see, it's a little bit more to the right than it is to the left. So all you're going to do is put your screwdriver back in through the coil and using the hilt of the screwdriver. And yes, I know that's a sword term. Using the hilt of the screwdriver, I'm just going to push the whole coil a little bit to the left. That's all. Just kind of wiggle it and just push it a little bit to the left. That's looking better. That's looking much better. Okay, so now we've got a coil. We're not done. Because we've made what's called a touching, a coil that all the wraps touch each other, it has a potential to have hot spots. Now what a hot spot is when there's seven wraps in a coil, you don't want it where one wrap or, you know, one wrap here or one wrap here heats up faster than the rest. Because what's going to happen is that's going to burn your juice and burn your cotton and give you the nastiest, shittiest tasting vape you'll ever have. And you don't want that. You may have already experienced that with the standard stock coils that come with your tank. So what we're going to do is we're going to remove any hot spots that are in this coil. And how we do that is we're going to fire it. So the first thing I'm going to need is the base to put it in. So I'm going to unscrew. You would have already had this unscrewed because this would be sitting there. This is what would be holding your stock coil where you take that, unscrew it, and throw it out. We're going to screw the RBA base, or the RBA deck, into our base. And tighten it down. Now, again, one of the things, a bit of advice I can give you a lot of times, it's okay to build on the base. You know, I could have had this in there the whole time while I was working. Again, I can sit it down on my little cheapy or even my larger screw-in. Again, it's a 510. It all sits nice. Okay, so now that we've got it attached to our device, what we're going to want to do is start pulsing it. Because what we want to do is remove any hot spots that are in the coil, much as I just described. So now if I start pulsing it, you'll see that it's not glowing from the center out. That's what we want. We want the inside of the coil, the center of it, to begin heating first. So we want the glow to appear in the center, work its way outwards, and then as it cools, get back to the center. You know, start from the center, work its way out, come back in. That's how you want it to glow when you pulse it. Now, when I look at this, it's starting to sort of glow from the center. At first it didn't, but again, without tweezers, I'm just going to take that straight screwdriver and, you know what, I'm even going to use the blue one. And all I'm going to do is I'm going to strum the coil, kind of like you'd strum a guitar. Not as hard, but that's it. I'm just going to strum the coil a few times, just very lightly. I'm just strumming it. What that does is it actually does put a little bit of space between each of those wraps, but the amount of space is unbelievably small. And it evens it out so that when you fire it, you'll get it glowing from the center towards the outside. Just like that. And that's what you want right there. Nice little coil burning from the center towards the outside. Now, again, the basic part, that's done. We can move on to the next part of wicking it now. But, in case any of you do have ceramic tweezers, want to know what the hell I'd use those for, let me just show you what you can do with these. So I can actually make these coils where they are touching. There is absolutely no space between them. And by that, how I do that is I heat it up till it's glowing. And once it's glowing, what I do is I'll actually let go of it from firing, and then I'll just give it a little pinch. Give it another fire. Give it a little pinch. Give it a little fire, give it a little pinch. I'm not squeezing it hard, not hard at all. Give it a fire, give it a pinch. give it a fire, give it a pinch, fire, pinch, fire, pinch, fire, pinch. Pretty boring, I know. Fire, pinch, fire, pinch. Now, if you're holding it, pinching it and holding it while it cools, it's more than likely going to be stay right where you put it. Meaning everything's touching. And again, with ceramic tweezers, I can fire it while I hold it. And I'm not going to burn myself. I'm not going to ruin the coil. I'm not squeezing it hard. I'm just pulsing it. And that's it. Now, let's have a look and see how it goes from inside towards out. Oh, that's sexy. That's sexy right there. Nice and even. Perfect. Now, we just need to wick it. Again, I'm going to remove it from the device because even though I can turn the device off, that still doesn't mean I can't accidentally turn the device back on. And especially while you're wicking it, I mean, what a pain in the butt, right? You just get your wick through there, it's all looking nice, and then you accidentally hit the fire button, boom, burn the cotton, now you gotta start over. Not the coil, but the wick. So, I'm going to remove it from the device. And at this point, you want to be careful not to drop it, because if you drop it with too much pressure and it hits, you can end up moving that coil, smacking it all out of whack, and you don't want to do that, because then you're back to kind of square one situation. So I'll grab my little tool here. In fact, I'm not even going to put it in screw down mode, I'm just going to put it in sit mode. And I'm going to show you both ways how to wick this. So, using the Cogendo cotton that comes with your deck, I'm going to cut off a piece. This is a 2.5, actually technically the screwdriver is 2.4 millimeters in diameter, and that's what the inside diameter of this coil is, 2.4 millimeters. So I just want to take a bit of cotton. Now this pad is pretty thick. And one thing I can tell you is after I cut this off, we're going to remove. It has almost like a tougher outer layer on this side as well as this side. And that's to just keep the cotton pad, you know, in one piece. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut about, somewhere's like a third of an inch or something. And I'm just going to cut a strip off of this piece of cotton. And the other important thing I'm going to teach about cotton is cotton has there's two ways that you know there's a you could cut this two ways. I could go against the grain or with the grain. When you're cutting your strip to make a wick, you want to cut with the grain. And the reason is because from lengthways, the cotton is very stiff. You know, it's hard. It's pretty hard. If you look at the cotton this way, and you pull on it, it just starts ripping apart. The fibers are all pretty much going in one direction. So, you know, you'll just rip it apart. So you don't want to cut against the grain. When you're making wicks, you want to cut with the grain. Now, if I move over to my cotton bacon, it's kind of similar. It's all in, you know, the grain's all going one way. In this case, I would just pinch off a piece to be about the width, you know, the diameter that I want, and then just peel it off, and that's it. Now, the same goes for both of these pieces. Now, with this Cogendo, I want to remove that tougher outer layer that's on both sides of the cotton. When it gets fluffy, you just kind of tap it down. And now I'm going to remove the other kind of side, just basically peeling off the top layer on each side. Now you can see it's starting to look more like the other one. And I'm just going to roll it between my fingers. Not too tightly, right? I just want to kind of get an idea, feel for the size. Another thing that you can do that I do is I put it in the palm of my hand and give it a little roll, you know? I'm just kind of compacting the cotton a little bit. Then what you're going to want to do is one end, whichever end, and the easiest way I can tell you is whichever end looks more pointy to begin with. Start there. And you want to... this part you want to get really tight. Really tight. Just keep rolling it between your two fingers, and you want to produce a really thin, thin point to the cotton. Because what you want to do is you're going to want to put this through the coil, right through the center of the coil. And grab it from the other side. Now you don't want to just rip it through or try to pull it through. If there's tension, too much tension, as you can see, there's tension. I'm going to pull this thing out of that base. What you want to do is on the back side, you want to hold this still and then twist the back side and give it a little pressure. Twist the back side, give it a little pressure, little bit of pressure, little bit, little bit. And what I'm doing is I'm just moving it through here till I get it to a spot that I like, you know, that I just go, And you want to pull it both ways. You want it to have some tension in that coil, but not jammed in there so tight you can't move it. You kind of want it to be fluffy when you're done and be able to, you know, pull a little bit back and forth through the coil. Again, that's just about getting the wicking perfect. You want it to be in there a little tight, but not too tight. And, you know, you can play with this, make it a little fluffy, because what we're going to do is we're going to trim this up. Because essentially, in this barrel that's going to go back over this, you'll notice... Maybe you won't notice. There's a couple of other holes. Other than the screw that holds the barrel to the base or to the deck, you're going to notice there's a nice size hole there. And around on the other side, you're going to see another nice size hole. That's actually where your juice will come into the through the barrel, touch the wick. The wick will soak up the juice, and then the wick will deliver the juice to your coil. So when we're done, this cotton is going to be pressed against the inside of the barrel right where the hole is. So how much cotton do we need? Well, you could have too much cotton, you could have not enough cotton. The perfect amount of cotton is it's covering the holes. That's the most important thing. You want it covering the holes. So I'm going to trim this now. Now where am I going to trim it? Well, if you lift up the cotton and you actually look, you'll know that these threads right here, this is where the base goes. That's where that barrel is going to screw down to these threads right here. But you don't want to trim this cotton, you know, perfectly in line with that, because then you have no room for error. You know, you will end up having a little bit of space, and that's no good, because then you'll get flooding. So what I like to do is I like to use the O-ring. Now, you may not have changed yours. I changed mine. So this is probably red on yours, if you haven't changed them. That's actually where I'm going to want to trim this, kind of by looking over the top of it and just kind of following where that rubber O-ring is. In fact, I can feel the rubber with the scissors. And then I'm just going to make a cut there. That's one side, and I'm going to do the exact same thing on the other side. Take those pieces, throw them away. Some people they're economy cotton. You keep trying to use little pieces, you're just going to cause yourself problems. So, there we go. It almost looks like a little bow tie of cotton. And that's it. And what you want to do is fluff it up. Make it so it's nice and fluffy. Because that's what you want. You want nice and fluffy. Essentially, I want to put that barrel over that and have this look like that, but inside the barrel. Okay? Now, of course, when I put the barrel over, it won't be like that, because I have to manipulate it already just to get the barrel over it. But that's where a screwdriver or a piece of wire comes in handy. So what I do is, and again, there's all sorts of different methods, different YouTube videos on how to do this. I put the little barrel set screw off to my left, and what I do is I lift the cotton up, being ever so nice and gentle, stroking it, nice friendly cotton, and I take the barrel, I line it up so that the groove that sits in the set screw is pointing to the left, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to start by putting in one side of the cotton. Now that's pretty easy. Now what I do is I put my thumb, press the cotton towards the center, and now I'm going to pull the barrel over the cotton. And if I do this right, there you go. We can put it right over the set screw, push it down till it's completely flush with the base. I'm going to turn it. I'm going to put my thumb on top of it to hold it down tight to the base. Take my little blue screwdriver, and I'm going to tighten the screw now. And just don't over-tighten, just nice and snug so that it holds the barrel. You'll know it's working if you can hold the barrel and the deck doesn't fall off in your hand. So there we go. Now, I know it's going to be hard to see, but as you can see, inside, it's a bloody mess. It's not all fluffy and covering the holes. Look, I mean, here, there's nothing in that hole. There's no cotton there whatsoever. Go to this side, you can just barely see the cotton there in a big, massive hole. If I were to throw this in my deck right now or in my tank and fill it up and juice it, and that's going to be a nightmare. So we need to manipulate that cotton and put it so that it's covering those holes. Last thing you want is really tight packed cotton, because you're not going to be able to, juice will not flow through it. The tighter it is, the more resistance it has for allowing the juice to flow through it. So you just want to lightly start pressing it down along the barrel, the inside of the barrel, like right around the inside. I'm just going to start pressing it down, and then look from the outside and see. You should see the cotton covering the hole. Now, if it looks like there's a little bit of gap on the bottom, but the top looks good and it looks good from inside, then even from the outside, from the little hole here, you can take your wire or screwdriver and just manipulate that cotton a little bit, just so that it's covering that hole really nice. There we go. That side's done. Perfect. Do the other side, same process. Poke it down. You want it covering the hole, but you don't want it, you want it covering the hole, but you don't want it compacted. Compacted it would not be good. So again, light and fluffy, covering the hole. That looks good. Oh, now there's something that's interesting. If you look at this, if you look at the profile, the cotton on this side is actually coming out the hole. Again, here it does too a little bit. Now, just so you know, that's fine. If I were to wick this up or juice it up and put it in the tank, it would still work. No problem. Now me, I'm a little OCD, and I don't like having my cotton coming out through the hole. So I'm going to actually push it back in. Now with my wire, the other end of this wire, I've got a little bend in it so that it's rounded, and this end, I can tell you, won't grab the cotton. And I'm just going to give it a little push inside, just so that it's not sticking through the hole. I don't like it sticking through the hole. I don't like the look of it. I mean, like I said, effectively, it still works the same. I'm just a little OCD. And again, on the other side, same thing. I'm just going to push it in a little bit. just so that it's not sticking out.
Great.
It's bloody immaculate. It's wonderful. All right, so now what we're going to do is we need to, what's called, prime this. Much like your stock coils, you're going to, anytime you take a brand new stock coil and you put it in your device, the first thing you want to do is prime it, put some juice in it. You don't want to just, you know, I mean, I could screw the cap on, put it in the tank with juice, let it sit there for 10 minutes, 15 minutes, pick it up and vape, no problem. But I don't have that kind of patience. So we're going to take some juice and we're going to get her going. So how I prime this is I'm going to start by just putting one drop on each side of the cotton from inside. One drop there, one drop there. Then what I do, what I like to do, is that hole where the cotton is touching, I like to put one drop on the hole. I don't like the air bubble. There we go. And the great thing is, if you actually hold it, watch, you'll see at that point when the cotton sucks the juice into the hole. It'll give you a good kind of understanding of wicking and how it works. Again, I'm just going to put one drop of juice on the cotton from outside, and you can see it goes, it starts off as a little bubble sitting on top of it, and you can see it just goes and gets sucked inside. And again, I'm going to put another drop inside on each side of the coil. That's it. We're wicked, we're primed. Next thing is replacing the top of the barrel cap. And that's just screwing it on. Again, it's got an O-ring. It's got nice threads. You just want to make sure that you don't cross-thread it. Much like anything you do here, you don't want to cross-thread anything. You'll feel it get a little tight as you get close. That's that O-ring grabbing the barrel. And again, because it's on and it has a set screw, you can spin it. It's not going to come off. And again, it's holding just fine. That is ready to go in your tank. Let's put it in. Here's my tank. I've got no juice in it because, like I said in the beginning of the video, I cleaned it, washed it all out. So we do need to fill up my tank with juice. I am going to, however, and again, I said it won't kill you and I promise it won't. There is some condensation in from when I cleaned it. So I'm going to take a piece of vapor towel. And yes, you heard correctly, that's what we call it, vapor towel. One of those geeky vaping things. You'll pick up on all that shit. Anyway, I'm going to take a little piece of paper towel. Oh, here's another. You know what? Let me give you this tip. I have paper towel sitting here. I also have a roll of paper towel sitting here. But what you'll learn is that as you start to do things, you'll get juice on your fingers. You'll want to wipe them. It's annoying when you're working and you're, you know, getting juice on your fingers. And trust me, it's going to happen. There is no way you can take builds apart, put them back together without getting juice on your fingers. The problem is, if you take off a whole sheet of paper towel, usually you end up wiping your fingers and you make a mess of this whole piece of paper towel. Environmentally, that's very unsound, you know. Considering that you get a little bit of juice on your fingers, what you actually need to get your fingers wiped off is that. The problem is you take this. So this ends up getting wasted because it gets all into a crumpled bloody mess because you're trying to get juice off your fingers, and you end up using a whole sheet of paper towel just when you needed this. So what I do is I take 4 or 5 sheets of paper towel, and I take my scissors and cut them into strips. I usually like 2 different sizes. And it just so that, you know, when I'm doing things, wiping, you know, maybe there's juice all over it and I want to wipe it down, I just take a little piece and wipe down what I need. And that way when I throw it out, I haven't used a whole piece of paper towel. You know, it takes 5 seconds to make this, you know, put 10 sheets together, take scissors and cut out what you want. It's a good tip. All right, so we're drying out my tank, the condensation off the inside of the glass. I'm just going to put a chunk of paper towel in here, or vapor towel, and just kind of roll it around. And you got to be careful because the metal will tend to want to grab the paper towel, and you don't want it to take it off and have little bits of, you know, paper towel inside your tank. I'm sure that, again, wouldn't hurt you, but I'm sure it would be pretty unpleasant if it ever hit the coil. You know, it'd be like, what the fuck's that taste? Oh, I'm burning paper towel on my coil. But there we go. We got rid of the condensation. A little blow. I said blow. And we're going to put some juice into this tank. Now, again, you know this from using the stock coils. You fill it up to the near the top of the chimney, and Bob's your uncle. Really nice juice from my local vape shop. This is called, it's Captain Oliver's Custards and Puddings, and this is called Galleon. It's like a vanilla custard with a hint of blueberry. Really nice. This is like my all-day vape. I go through like 120ml bottle of this every month, and 120ml of another one that's one of their brands. I really like this stuff. So there we go. We've got our tank filled. We've got our RBA deck. All beautifully coiled, wicked up, ready to go. Another good tip, what I like to do so that I know that my build and my tank is wicking correctly, if you look through the glass, you're going to see those big holes that are in the side of the tank. I like to turn it, tighten it enough, you know, you want it to be sealed, which at this point it is. If I left it like this, it's perfectly sealed. But what I like to do is make sure that those wick holes are not behind the metal supports, because I like to know that it's wicking correctly. And how you know that it's wicking correctly is when you see bubbles rising out of the juice holes, right? So now that's too tight, so I'm going to back it back off. And I like to, again, OCD, I like to have that juice port, as they call it, or juice port, right in the center between the two silver supports there. Again, that's just me being OCD. Now that that's in there, you don't want to vape on it just yet. Even though we primed it, and I could put it on a device and go and vape away on it, I don't want to. I like to leave it just to make sure that cotton is, you know, is having a wonderful, beautiful relationship with the juice that is now surrounding it. So we'll put that aside and we'll let it sit there for a couple of minutes and let it be perfect. In the meantime, what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you this. This is the Coil Master. Like I say, again, it's a great, you know, bunch of guys in China made this. This is the version 3. It comes with 6 different diameter rods and things. You remember watching me make the coil on the screwdriver. It was doable, but it's really a pain in the ass. Rips your fingers apart with the wire. And like I told you, I was going to show you this. Here's how easy it is to make a coil using a Coil Master, a jig. I'm just going to put the wire in through the little hole there. I'm going to just hold it with my thumb. Put my cap on. I'm going to push the wire down a little bit to start it. And then I'm going to, if you can see, there's a center hole. That's where the rod goes. And then there's a little screw. That little screw is what's going to push this wire around the rod. Now watch how easy this is. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Remember we said we'd do 8? 8. Okay, and it's springy, so you want to go a little bit more than what you think you do, then let it up. Now, pull it out, I put it back on. Remember, we're going to take one out, right? And again, this time I'm going to, you know, this is, you know, if you have pliers around, this is much easier. Go ahead, grab that lead, and I'm going to pull one wrap out. There we go. Now, that's a perfect touching coil, and it was so much easier to do. Trust me, when you try it on this, it's doable. It's hard. It's a pain in the ass. It's hard on the fingers. This is a joke. This is a breeze. If you're going to build any coils, you'll want something like this. It just makes it so much easier. And that's the Coil Master. Again, it's like $25 US. And it comes with like, well, there's three of these because each one of them is two sizes. One side's one way, one side's the other way. Comes with the six different rods. It ranges in size from 1.5 millimeter all the way up to 4 millimeter, so in half millimeter increments. So it's really kind of universal. You can get a lot of different, create a lot of different size coils with this. The mandrel, another thing I'll discuss. Now, much as I built on the screwdriver, which is kind of a manual, this thing's almost like a machine. It's, you know, it's almost like not doing anything yourself. You know, if they put a battery in it, I'd call it a, you know, anyway. You can also do the same thing on the mandrel. In fact, that's what the mandrel's for. It even tells you, it has sizes here. The biggest part's 3.5 mil, then 3 mil, then 2.5, then 2, then 1.5. Now, for instance, 2.5 mil would be this center one out of the 5. And this would work much like doing it on the screwdriver. You'd start your coil on it and start wrapping around this thing. Now, I'm not going to wrap a whole coil, but I'm just going to use this as an example to show you that you know, this is 2.4 millimeters. So knowing what I know, I can tell you this should fit right through either one of these little coily bits that I made. It fits through there, and it fits through there. So yeah, Coil Master, mandrel. Again, this tool is nice when you're building, because you can put this on, and then you can use this to manipulate, you know, push your coil, push it over, you know, lift it up, push it down. And this one's more substantial than using the little screwdriver. The other thing is, you can use the Coil Master for the same thing. The problem with using the Coil Master for that is because the handle's so big, it doesn't give you, you know, like if this was my deck, you know, I don't have a lot of room because that handle is in the way. Now, what I've done in the past, before I bought my mandrel, again, $7 purchase, local vape shop, is I've taken the rod out of my Coil Master, which is, that's how you replace the rods for different size coils, and I've used this little part to act as a, you know, something to hold my coil while I'm putting it in a device. This works actually even better than the screwdriver, not as good as the mandrel. But yeah, it's all on what works for you. The important thing is that, you know, you built the coil yourself. You did it yourself. You know, there's a certain amount of satisfaction knowing that you did this. You made a coil, you wicked it up, you primed it, you put it in the tank, you checked the resistance, you fired it down, and there's a certain amount of self-satisfaction from doing it yourself. All right. So, we've let that sit for a minute. Now, I am going to give it a quick vape, even before I put the camera back up, so you can see my wonderful shining face. That's a joke. Anyway, I'm going to put it on my device. We're going to have a look at the resistance. This coil is coming in at 0.52 ohms. So what you usually what you want to you're shooting for with this particular build is about 0.5 ohms. Some devices will only read down to one decimal place, like my iStick 50. If I were to throw it on here, it's either going to read 0.5 or 0.6, depending how it decides to read the next decimal place. That's kind of weird about this device. This iStick TC40W is more accurate, and it's reading it at 0.52. I'm not sure if you're going to be able to read that, but there it is there. I have it set to 18 watts, and I'm going to take it for a vape. And this is the coil we built. You can see that's the tank with the black rings. This is what we just built, you and I. That's got some nice flavor. This kicks ass when you compare this to the OCC coil heads that the stock coils that you buy. Not only does this kick ass, I made it. You made it. You can't beat that. Let me bump it up a little bit. We're gonna put it up to 24 watts. That seems to be about my sweet spot. I don't know what it is. I just like the vape that these give off, these coils at this size, I like the vape at 24 watts. Again, that's personal preference. But let me take a hit off it at 24 watts. And you can see what that's like. Okay, it's vaping really nice. I'm gonna move the camera up now, and we'll close this out. We can have a nice little vape on it, and we can all revel in the wonderful work that we've done. Okay, welcome back. We're back up from building. As you can see, I've got my my device on here. It's the coil we just built. It's wicking real nice. It's, I've got my little air bubbles coming up from my juice channels. Again, like I said, it's reading at 0.52 ohms. I'm going to hit this at 24 watts, and we're going to see what kind of clouds we're going to get out of this sub-tank mini. Thanks for watching the video. We're going to vape on this. Thanks for watching the video, and don't forget to like and subscribe. Cheers. Really nice. I'm telling you, I smoked cigarettes for 36 years, and I picked up my first e-cig about 3 months ago. And after 3 days, I had my last cigarette, and I haven't had one since. And trust me, I was a hardcore smoker. Hardcore. 36 years. I started smoking when I was 11 years old, and the longest I ever went without a cigarette was 8 hours. That's it. 8 hours in that whole 36 years. Anytime I ever tried to quit, it was just, like I said, one day. There was one day in my 20s. I was determined. I thought, that's it. I'm going to quit smoking. I went about 8 hours before I nearly ripped somebody's fucking head off, and I said, that's it, I gotta go buy smokes. And the funny thing is, in all those years, nothing has helped me quit smoking, but this has. And you know, the fact that I have, it's almost like a new hobby. I get to play around, I build my own coils. It's a lot of fun, it's very satisfying. And the thing is, part of me never wanted to quit because I enjoyed smoking so much. It wasn't just about nicotine and it wasn't about wanting to put things in my mouth. It was, I enjoyed smoking. I like to smoke. The best part is now, this is 95% more healthy for you. And I'll tell you something, it's even more satisfying than cigarettes. I much, much, much prefer this than I do cigarettes. And let's take a few vapes as we close this video up. Again, thanks to Kanger Subtank users, and thanks to you. Cheers. Beautiful flavor, beautiful flavor. Again, you follow this tutorial, you build it just like this, no dry hits, no dry hits at all. And you may be saying, hey, Vapor Noob, I want to push this thing to 40 or 50 watts. My question to you is, why? Look at this, at 24 watts, I'm getting beautiful, dense, flavorful vapor at 24 watts. I don't need to push this to 40. There's no reason to. I could. I might even end up getting a burnt hit at that point, but that's the whole idea. Why bother? At 24 watts, this thing's hitting like a beast. And so that you know you've wicked it right, you should be able to, what they call, chain vape it. And I'm going to show you that too, so that you can see that this build that we've created, it will wick and it will wick and it will hit and it will wick and it will hit. I'm going to take like 10 pulls in a row off this and you'll see I won't get any dry hit, because if I do, you'll see me start choking my ass off. What a nice vape. Beautiful flavor. Excellent tank. Excellent build. Do it this way, you won't have any fails. I promise. Guaranteed. You got Vapor Noob guaranteed. You follow this exactly like I showed you, you're going to be satisfied. That I guarantee to you. And on a signing out, I'm going to put this to something stupid so that you can see it'll still hit to, I don't know, 35 watts. Let's try that. Because that's stupid and that's something I'll never do. But 35 watts. Gets a little warm on the lips, not burning, a little warm on the lips, warmer than I like. Like I told you in the beginning, that's why I use the little adapter. I like my lips a little further from the action. But it's a nice vape even at 35 watts. Cheers.